Hi there. I'm Doug Devins from Prescix Medical, and I'm here to talk about everybody's favorite topic, colonoscopies. Seriously though, endoscopy has changed healthcare. It's revolutionized it, reducing costs to the system because you don't have the long patient recovery times. And because of that, the number of endoscopic procedures keeps going up well faster than surgical procedures overall. Now, on the right, you can see actually the working end of one of those duodenoscopes that's been associated with the outbreak. You can see how hard that would be to clean. On the left, you see biofilm on the end of a colonoscope. Oh, sorry, and that was actually cleaned. That's the source of infection outbreaks right there. So, and what happens, because they're so hard to clean, you get infection outbreaks. You get Virginia Mason. You get, 200 people there. You get UCLA. You get various other instances, and we calculate that the status quo is adding something like $100 to the cost of each endoscopic procedure through liability and extra hospitalizations. So the hospitals are moving it over to the, and moving the endoscope reprocessing over to the sterilization departments. They're used to doing quality control checks. They don't have problems. What they're finding out is that endoscopy has no quality control checks, and they're desperate for a solution. They want to know if that thing is safe to use. We have data showing that you can get that 3-hour response. We have filed IP on the system and on its method of use. $3.5 million will get us through the 510K approval. And we see a global market on the order of $1 billion by 2024. We could hit $40 million within 5 years just on our target market of those sterilization processing departments right out of the gate. Finally, we have the team to do it. Satoshi Ishii, professor here at the university, expert in this technology, and I have experience in disinfection and sterilization assurance and 10 plus device launches. Thank you.
Is yours a proprietary technology?
Yes, we have filed on it. The combination and some of the particular embodiments are absolutely proprietary and unique. And then, of course, we have the method of use. It's actually based on polymerase chain reaction. It's that combination with the polymerase chain reaction, the bacterial concentration, and the viability that makes us different.
Do you control all the pieces of the solution?
We do. Yeah, we would actually be providing a piece of capital equipment that would do all three for the hospital. And then we would basically, like a Keurig cup in a Keurig coffee maker, put in the little reagent Keurig cup, and then our piece of equipment runs the test and does all three steps.
So PCR is well trained.
That's right.
The reagents that you're using for this, are these proprietary?
The primers that we would be providing, primers for PCR, those particular genes that we would be targeting would be for gram-negative staph aureus. Those, the particular genes would be proprietary, that would be part of the IP, relatively narrow IP. It's the system and the method of use, the combination and the method of use that's the unique part.
How easy is that to circumvent?
I think you can get around any patent. I've got around a few in my day, but I believe that this is going to be a tougher one. So
the value of $100 per procedure, what's your ASP?
The ASP would be $8 to get to that $1 billion global market compared to the 100 of the costs of the status quo.
Have you done any tests to know how many false negatives you have?
We're still in the early stage. No, we have not. But we actually have done a false positives, and we're actually not getting any false positives. But obviously, we'd have to do validation, and that would be the submission to the 510K.
Today,
they're not doing anything, and that's because the only test they got is a bacterial culture that takes 48 hours and requires a microbiology degree. What's the rate of failure? Based on the FDA MAUDE database, we calculate on the order of 1 in 10,000, but the problem is each time that happens, you're getting 30 to 50 people infected. UCLA was 170, Virginia Mason was a couple hundred. Ouch, because you can't tell. And by the time you figure it out, you've already got a couple hundred people infected, or at least 30.
What has your VOC told you about willingness to adopt?
I work in the sterilization assurance field with these people, and as I said, they're desperate. They would be willing. Of course, they're going to be cost sensitive. This is not a profit center, but and you know the numbers that I've kind of bandied about with them, they've said that was reasonable.